Carry on my wayward son. There'll be peace when you are done. Lay your weary head to rest. Don't you cry no more.
Good morning. My name is Jay Egg with Egg Geo. I am a writer and a consultant for geothermal HVAC technologies. And in this wonderful, crazy new world we have, webinars are the thing to do. I've done a lot of webinars in the past, but I've been asked to do even more so that there can be some more home learning. So I hope that you enjoy this webinar I'm going to do today. It's going to run for about 40 or 45 minutes. So get comfortable and just become prepared to learn a little bit about geothermal. One of the most popular articles I've written in the last couple of years has to do with the Water-Energy Nexus and geothermal systems. As always, we need to talk about the proprietary nature of the content of this video. Please share it, but please give credit where credit is due. I've spent about 35 years in the industry working on this topic. This is based on a November 2018 plumbing engineer article entitled The Water-Energy Nexus in Geothermal Systems. A little bit about why this is important. I've been involved in code committees, technical committees, since 2015. I've served on the International Association of Plumbing and Mechanical Officials Uniform Solar Hydronics and Geothermal Code Committee, and most recently on the 2021 Uniform Mechanical Code Committee. We have put a lot of the Canadian standard CSA 448 into these codes. Some revisions have gone into these codes. So there's a lot of geothermal content now in the codes, and we're actually working on the 2024 Uniform Mechanical Code, which has a lot of surprises, which are going to come up in upcoming webinars. We're also in the midst of, I do a little bit of work for New York State, and we're in the midst of working on the New York State Model Ground Source Heat Pump Building Permit for Residential Systems. And this is had the input of many dedicated professionals over the last perhaps year, and we hope to finish it sometime this year. Just as a basic, a little set of basics for those who may not have been involved in geothermal systems so far, there are a couple of different types of geothermal systems that you can put in geothermal systems that involve heat pumps, or you can put in geothermal systems that involve central chiller energy plants with heat recovery, for example. Distributed heat pumps are one way, central energy plants are another. And there are certainly more than that, but I wanted to cover those two and talk a little bit about the fundamentals of small, as you see on the left, a house with a single geothermal exchange source. In this case, it's a pump and reinjection. Sometimes it's a well, or an entire campus. The actual heat pumps can look a little bit like the image on the left. These are commercial grade geothermal heat pumps, or like the chiller energy plant on the right. On slide number 9, we have an indication. It's kind of a visual representation of the water energy nexus. The water energy nexus is a term that is used to describe the interdependence between water and energy in our lives. In the development of master plan communities, the water energy nexus is front and center and is yet to realize its full potential. As an example, the U.S. Department of Energy estimates that 350 billion kilowatt hours a year of energy paid for by our citizens goes down the drain. You might ask, how does that go down the drain? Well, think about all of the wastewater that goes out of our homes and our businesses. And as you do this, look at this image that we have here on the screen. you've got a storm and sewer exchange indication here. And as you look at this cross-section of New York State's underground, actually New York City's underground, you can see the potable water, the wastewater, the gas lines, and all these other lines, including regular drinking water lines running under. What you might not realize, and what we won't have time to talk about today, is the fact that they're dewatering subways continually. These subways don't stay dry by themselves. Now, that's just the beginning. All we're talking about here is opening up our minds to this water-energy nexus. Remember, the water-energy nexus is a term used to describe the interdependence between water and energy in our lives. In this next slide from the article I wrote, it's entitled Moving Out of Silos and Into Thermal Advantage. And I would ask you, what does that really mean, moving out of silos? Is that just a term that we throw around a lot? No, it's really kind of a problem. Let me first talk about what Ball State University and Stanford have done with their campuses, and then we will talk a little bit about these silos and some of the issues that we're dealing with, and maybe some of the ways we can work our way out of these issues. Ball State University, and you can Google it. I should probably jump into it here, but I'm not going to because I think I'll run out of time, and I want to keep this to just 30 or 40 minutes. But Ball State has completely converted from all of its coal heating to thermal advantage and energy sharing coupled to earth loops. Stanford, which is indicated on the screen here, went from a natural gas combined heat and power fired campus to a campus that shares energy. Now let's just take a look for a minute as I show you this slide down here, inset, that shows the amount of cooling energy represented above this line and the amount of heating energy, which is represented below this line. These two processes were operating completely out of communication or synchronization one with another. And while many people may say, well, that's how it works, that doesn't have to work that way. And that's part, again, of this water-energy nexus. If you have water or fluid for a central energy plant, or if you have a condenser water or a house loop, that water has entrained BTUs that can be shared with other parts of the building or campus. When Stanford did the study on this, they realized that this yellow area here was heat recovery potential. What was before used, the energy that was attained from combustion heating is now attained by waste heat from cooling. It's that simple. All of the energy for cooling can be thrown over to the heating potential or for the possibility of heating parts and pieces of a campus or a building in any instance. What we see here is the amount of waste heat from cooling that simply is not needed by the campus. And over here at these peaks, we see some of the excess heat that they just can't get from waste cooling operations. So in the case of this wasted cooling energy, that has to go out through the cooling towers, and this heating energy that is not made up by waste heat from cooling has to be made up by gas heating. However, you're going to find out by the end of this, they have managed to get completely off combustion heating through the use of a geothermal exchange system. Just so I can explain a little bit what's going on in this picture with this central energy plant, these three large water tanks are for thermal energy storage and a high voltage substation that receives electricity from the grid. A key feature of this central energy facility is an innovative heat recovery system that takes advantage of Stanford's overlap in heating and cooling needs. In addition, the central energy facility, the Stanford Energy System, they actually call it the SESI, or Stanford Energy System Innovations, project converted the heat supply from all of the buildings from steam to hot water. Steam is very common in many places, central steam systems or steam distribution systems. It's just not necessary, and it's not practical for heat recovery to try to stay with the steam system. So they're typically in new buildings converted over to medium temp water systems, meaning something under 160 degrees. As we move into slide number 11, this image is a representation of all of the potential just about any well-built neighborhood or community might have underneath the ground that could be used for energy exchange, especially, and I'm going to mention this word again, as we move out of silos. Let's talk about some of the things that run underground. We've got rainwater, which is the rain caught from the roof and other direct methods of rain capture. We've got stormwater, which is where the rainwater is conducted that's reached the ground and other hard surfaces. We've got irrigation runoff. We've got gray water. We've got treated effluent from a sewage treatment plant. And even untreated wastewater using different methods, which we'll cover in another webinar, can be used as a method of heat transfer using special heat pumps that are designed to extract heat from raw wastewater. These are all alternative supplies and they're part of this effort. And when treated as required, are suitable for a myriad, a range of purposes. Sometimes agricultural lands, horticultural, industrial processing, and residential dual pipe programs will help do this. It's a matter of if you're master planning a community, kind of like you see at this Whisper Valley in Texas, you can put in a central energy or condenser water line for geothermal systems. If you're doing a remodel or a rework of infrastructure in a community, you might be able to use new ambient geothermal lines that could be put in. You might be able to use exchange of gray water lines and install exchange. I'll show you a little bit about how that works in a later slide. We're getting a lot of interesting input from big players like New York State and other states, and from foreign countries that are utilizing infrastructure for geothermal exchange. In the first slide in this series, we're on slide 12 here, which shows a little bit about what the facilities engineer Joseph Stagner used, kind of as a simplified hydronic schematic at Stanford for his SESI system. Now you remember we talked about SESI standing for Stanford's Energy and Sustainability Initiative. If we go back up to the beginning and take a look at this image right here, remember that there are several ways to do a geothermal exchange system. You can do it with a supply and reinjection mode like this, and you can see this in a campus application similar to Stanford's. Or you could do, I've got another image here that'll give you kind of an idea of the most standard type of geothermal system. And it involves just a simple single loop from connected to a home. This is representative of that single loop, and you can see this is probably how 90% of certainly one-off geothermal systems, but also many campuses and large systems are done with vertical bores like this. And this would be a closed loop that involves heat transfer fluid within the pipe. The difference between this and this type of system right here is that this is actually pumping water from an aquifer. And the reason we're focusing on this for this particular presentation is that because that's the way that Stanford did theirs, is doing their system. They're using heat transfer from a supply and injection well system to transfer heat with the main heat exchanger, which also provides, as you can see here, additional groundwater supply. So once again, as part of the Water Energy Nexus, you're doing more than one thing with energy and with fluid, and it just makes great sense. So once it goes through a heat exchanger, and I have some images of those heat exchangers in a little bit, you can see it's got a little bit of an approach, about 6 degrees of heat transfer difference, and this goes into heat recovery chillers, which provide chilled water for the loop to and from the campus and hot water for the buildings. In this case, they're using a heat recovery chiller that takes 130 degree water back and puts 170 degree water out. And of course, chilled water is in the 40 to 46 degree range. So getting back to our basic tenet, the master design of mixed-use communities use all facets of infrastructure as a single body. This is where people need regulatory bodies, authorities having jurisdiction, anybody that is at the legislative level needs, for the purposes and the good of the sustainability and renewable energy in our communities, they need to get out of their silos and work together, especially in new construction, but also in reworks. When you consider the number of streets in the United States and the world that are being torn up for infrastructure projects such as new water lines or such as natural gas upgrades, which is an entire new subject or other subject that I've got a recent article on in Plumbing Engineer. As a matter of fact, let me see. I have my my issue here of this March 2020 PHC News, and I write for that as well as Plumbing and Heating Contractor. You can see the article there is New Contractor Opportunities with Geothermal Districts. And this involves replacing old failing natural gas pipelines with new geothermal microdistricts. So I really highly recommend you take the opportunity to go online and check out your March 2020 Plumbing and Heating Contractor. It's also in, I think, the February Plumbing Engineer, but more geared toward engineers. Either way, you're going to learn a lot from it because it chronicles an actual project that is going on in Massachusetts right now where the gas company is converting and has applied to the Regulatory Commission to replace natural gas pipelines with geothermal microdistricts. That is getting people out of silos, and that's what we need. One of the most valuable resources we can use as an energy industry, as a heating and cooling industry, as a plumbing industry, is recycled water. Recycled water is a valuable resource. It contributes to conservation of drinking water. It improves reliability of our water supplies. It frees up water for the environment or growth. It reduces the amount of treated effluent discharge into our bays and oceans. If you're in an area like Las Vegas, Nevada, certain parts of Texas, Southern California, water is extremely valuable. You might not think this, but water is extremely valuable and expensive in Florida because of saltwater intrusion and a myriad of other issues. We have been crippled by restrictions on freshwater pumping. It's interesting to note that with regard to freshwater pumping, they are talking about consumptive use. Consumptive use means the water is being used and put down the drain into the sewer, or it's being evaporated, or it's being put onto lawns. Interestingly enough, pumping water from the ground for geothermal exchange is not consumptive because the water is put right back in the ground. We'll get back to that in a little bit, but right now I want to talk about something really kind of interesting that I think is worth talking about because it has a conclusion that's a little bit bizarre. William Buck Elementary School in Valley Stream, New York, and that's actually in Long Island, in 2015, they worked with American Water Commissioner Patricia Acampora, and they worked with the New York Public Service Commission, and they took a water main, and I'm going to just show you with my cursor. They took a water main. You could see them actually installing this here, and they tapped into it for the sole purpose of running this drinking water through an exchanger that would provide heat source and heat sink for the cooling and heating processes in the school. Now, this particular school only had gas heaters when they conceived this project. So in 2015, they actually tapped into the water main. They ran the water main into the school. They actually built this heat exchanger shed, a very small room where they do the heat exchange, separate from the campus. You can see in the heat exchanger room here, these are circulating pumps for the condenser water. You can see the condenser water is in the kind of light green as it is here, and the fresh water or the potable water is in the aqua blue pipes here. This is a double wall titanium plate and frame exchanger that exchanges the heat of the potable water with the condenser water loop in the building. The condenser water loop then runs through the building and provides heating and cooling water for dozens of geothermal heat pumps within the building. As I said, this is a 40,000 square foot school that has had heating and cooling without putting any loop infrastructure in since 2015. In this slide here, you can see one of the larger multi-purpose room heat pumps. This is probably a 25 or 30 ton, again, the line running to the school. And you can see them cutting the line through. This is a representation of how the geothermal pilot system was put in. They actually put in a diffusion well and ran some of the water to the sanitary sewer until they could make a determination that this was a safe system. So this is how the system was designed to operate for the first several years. Here's another image that indicates, you know, some of the heat pumps above the ceiling for the individual classrooms. They also used several package terminal or console units in the classrooms in place of the perimeter induction heaters. And I have some images of those that I'll cover later on. The interesting thing, kind of a compelling fact, very compelling to me, is that Oak Ridge National Labs, a national laboratory, Dr. Xiaobing Liu, did a study together with Ellen D. Smith, and this 50-page study is available. It came out in 2018 or 19, and this is what the executive summary says, because it was studying whether this type of potable water exchange is safe. Is it safe for the water to run through an exchanger? I mean, this is a total no-duh thing to me, if ever there was one. I mean, we use refrigeration for water fountains, we use refrigeration for ice machines, we use refrigeration for everything. But here, nonetheless, is an executive summary proving we can handle our potable water well. It says, review of the data identified no conditions that would prevent the use of heat exchange outflow water for water supply. Inflow and outflow water quality conforms with applicable regulatory standards. There were no discernible differences between inflow and outflow water quality for any parameters. And if you click on this hyperlink for Oak Ridge National Labs, which you can just look up by yourself, the evaluation of the impacts of heat exchange operation, quality of water used as a heat source and heat sink, you're going to find the document. So I invite you to do it, to download it, and have it for yourself. A large part of the Water Energy Nexus is to realize that surface water exchange is fundamentally, simply the easiest source of water, of heat exchange you can do, because it doesn't involve a lot of excavation for the closed loops. It doesn't involve well drilling to go down and get groundwater. It doesn't involve a 2,200-foot borehole for a standing column well. And in a future webinar, I'm going to talk about those 2,200-foot boreholes for standing column wells. But for right now, I just want to show one example of using surface water that's adjacent to a facility for exchange, partly because this is exactly how Stanford is going to finish up their project, and I believe they've already completed it with a lake water heat exchange system that will provide all of the source heat, or at least most of the source heat they need for their surplus, or the heating that they can't get from waste cooling from the cooling, and will provide all of the heat rejection and stop the operation of cooling towers. Cooling towers consume a tremendous amount of water, and they are a source of Legionnaire's disease, especially if they're not managed properly. I mentioned to you that I'm on the IAPMO committees for 2021 and 2024. One of the subcommittees that I've had the privilege of chairing is the Legionella Cooling Tower Subcommittee. It's such a concern. It is an epidemic, certainly not a coronavirus level epidemic, but it's an epidemic that manifests itself exactly like the coronavirus. And as a matter of fact, it's become a great focus for the 2024 Energy Code and the Uniform Mechanical Code. But back to what I'm talking about right now, this surface water exchange is pretty amazing. So as you look at this, this quarry that they Nashville Airport used, you can see that from the text here, the Nashville Airport used to have three 1,100-ton cooling towers. These have been eliminated, and with the elimination of the cooling towers, as part of the benefits of doing this, they have saved thousands of man hours of maintenance spent on the cooling towers normally, thousands of gallons of chemicals used for cooling tower management, millions of gallons of fresh water consumption, and then the periodic cooling tower overhaul and replacement costs are eliminated. There also is no noise from cooling towers. The footprint on the ground is able to be used for something else. Now look at this schematic, and you can see that they ran completely under the airport runways and out to some quarry that looks kind of like a retention pond. It was probably a quarry that was used for road building at some point. Nonetheless, it is standing water now and worked out perfect for 3,300 tons of heat exchange. You can have a little bit of a view of some of the efforts. These are the cooling towers here at the Central Energy Plant, and they had to pipe it out the roadside, and they actually did some tunneling. This is pretty hard ground. It's rock. And of course, those who work in rock know how to cut and trench in rock. It's not something that everybody is familiar with, but if you do it all the time, that works. So this $10.4 million project is saving the Nashville Airport about $430,000 a year. This webinar is not about necessarily the Nashville Airport, but this is just one of those examples of things that need to be have some attention and paid to them, and they need to have more people need to have a knowledge that this is available. As a matter of fact, 85% of the population of the world lives near surface water, close enough that they can take advantage of surface water. Now, how do I know that? It's just an average of some studies that have been done in the UK. That doesn't mean it's exactly right. It might be 75%. It might be 80%. But if you think about where populations rise up, they usually rise up near surface water. And if there's surface water nearby, this is one of those silo things I've been talking about. We need to use that surface water for heat exchange. We hear so many things about concerns for fish eggs, and certainly these type of habitat concerns are important, but let's get over them, get through them, and start using this heat exchange. You know what's really dangerous is using a cooling tower if there's a chance somebody's not going to maintain it and it's going to have a Legionella outbreak. I am not damning cooling towers. I'm simply saying there's a better way that uses less energy, so let's consider using it. Going back to our Stanford example, when we get out of silos and start using this thermal advantage, I would ask you, what is the coefficient of performance of a good heat pump? The coefficient of performance, just for a quick reminder, is simply this. If you have electric resistance heating strips, whether it's a space heater, whether it's a blow dryer, whether it's a 5 kW or 10 kW set in an air handler, they have a coefficient of performance of 1, because if you use 1 kilowatt of energy, you get out 1 kilowatt of heat. The reason a geothermal heat pump, or any heat pump for that matter, an air source heat pump, the reason a geothermal heat pump in this case is so efficient is because it is not a heat-creating device. It doesn't use combustion heating or electric resistance heating to make heat. It's a pump, like a water pump. It pumps energy from one place to another. In this case, a geothermal heat pump uses 1 unit of electrical power from the grid to pump 4 units of free energy from the earth. This is just, over here, a pictorial indication of what the earth's energy comes from. The earth is a large solar collector, so 50% of the energy that strikes the earth's surface or the earth's atmosphere is absorbed by surface water and land. So when you're talking about getting energy from the ground, it's literally solar energy, the shallow earth. So back to this slide from Stanford, when we're, by moving out of these silos and sharing energy, we're taking a heat pump that might have a coefficient of performance of, say, 3 or 4, which is extraordinary. It's absolutely extraordinary if you consider it, because we're getting 400% efficiency or 500% efficiency. I've been called a liar or some type of sorcerer, because I even say this, because people that are in the fossil fuel industry or the combustion heating industry say it's impossible to even have more than 100% efficiency. But we know better, because we're not creating heat, we're moving heat from one place to another. So now that we understand that, we have a heat pump that's got a 3 or 4 COP, as is kind of indicated down here. System 1 has a 3-point-something COP. System 2 has a 3.2 COP. What happens when you start sharing energy between the cooling processes and the heating processes? Well, you get kind of a complementary effect. What is that complementary effect? Well, it almost becomes a sort of passive heating or cooling. Not quite. You still need mechanical work to get it to where it needs to be. But look at these combined EER or COPs. This system, using these two systems here, has a combined COP of almost 10, which is unattainable by technology we have today, unless you use heat recovery. Get out of the silos, get into heat recovery, start using systems to our advantage by sharing energy. There are 6 strategic pillars, at least that I've been able to identify, that address the water energy nexus in communities of any size. Optimize freshwater efficiency of energy production, electrical generation, and end-use systems. That's a very overarching kind of general statement. But a lot of these are, but they really kind of speak to what we're trying to do in a big way. Optimize the energy efficiency of water management, treatment, distribution, and end-use systems. enhance the reliability and resilience of energy and water systems, increase safe and productive use of non-traditional water sources. That's where we talked about, it could be seawater, it could be lake water, it could be retention pond water, it could be effluent. When we talk about non-traditional water sources, we're talking about utilizing the water to the max, to its maximum capability for energy exchange and for human needs, whether it's bathing, flushing toilets, even potable water use. Promote responsible energy operations with respect to water quality, ecosystem, and seismic impacts, and exploit the productive synergies among water and energy systems. This is something that has to be done at the legislative level. What I'm talking about here is that project at the Valley Stream School in Long Island, New York. Even though Oak Ridge National Laboratories stated that there were no discernible differences between inflow and outflow water quality for any parameters, we had a Department of Health that had one clause in their books from decades ago that said no potable water from the public system can be used for energy exchange with refrigeration systems. We're not talking about using private use of potable water and then putting it back into the water system. We're talking about the water company getting into the energy business and sharing, and since this water is being pumped all over, using the energy exchange to the greatest extent possible. A municipally owned facility. Remember the little shed I showed you from the Valley Stream project? You put in a shed like this, you have a domestic water supply. You could even use this heat exchange source before it gets treated at the water treatment facility. Certainly the water company is going to be safe enough to use the after the pre-treated potable water. But then the water company sells this energy throughout the neighborhoods, this energy exchange system, because they've got the water moving by at the rate of millions of gallons a minute anyway, at least tens of thousands of gallons a minute for many larger facilities, and certainly millions of gallons per minute when you consider large cities as a whole. This water has the potential to do a tremendous amount of energy exchange. Would you like more? In the case of Toronto, they 15 years ago put in, and here is the link to it right here if you want to copy that down and go and check it. They put in a potable water exchange system that was tied into Lake Ontario 15 years ago, ran the water through the treatment system to make it potable water. After it runs through the treatment system and is potable water quality, they run it through this bank of heat exchangers, and then the water is distributed not only for drinking water, but for chilled water for the entire Toronto downtown network of buildings, 73,000 tons. 15 years they've been doing this, and yet we've got silos. That's what I call them, and that's what they are. We've got the Department of Health that can't get together with the Department of Energy and say, yes, we have a resource that should be used. The waste treatment plants continue to dump effluent into rivers, which is fine, except that we should be grabbing the energy from that, either underground through our communities on the way, or as the water's being put out. We could have energy plants similar to this example that I just showed a few moments ago. So with regard to these strategic pillars, I would simply ask you, as mechanical professionals, as mechanical contractors, as plumbing officials, plumbing contractors, be aware of this because it does make a difference. I'm passionate about it. I do a lot of writing about this technology. Most know that I have written a couple of books with great co-writers from McGraw-Hill. In 2010, I wrote Geothermal HVAC, Green Heating and Cooling. You can get it online at Amazon and McGraw-Hill at the ASHRAE bookstore or any one of dozens of other places. In 2013, I wrote that with Brian Clark Howard, who is went to National Geographic and now is a writer for at a news desk in D.C. I don't envy him right now, but I love him. And then in 2013, I got together with a hydronics icon, Greg Cuniff, and the grandfather of standing column well design, Carl Oreo, and we wrote Modern Geothermal HVAC Engineering and Control Applications for graduate level studies. We are very, I am very much, and is are my associates at my company, Egg Geo LLC. We're passionate about sharing information. We've worked together with many entities to create educational resources for professionals as well as for children. I invite you to go on to egggeo.com and take a look at some of these. This is kind of fun because you can see the original concept, the sketches, and the artwork done. This artwork is not cheap. It costs thousands of dollars. And this is not a profit center. This is a free sharing opportunity. Many of you may not know this, but as a writer, I don't charge anything for my writing or for doing these webinars. It's informational. I'm not poor mouthing. I make plenty of money off of engineering and consulting projects that I get called in on, but I'm passionate about this industry. I feel I'm an evangelist for the industry. I hope that all of you have a wonderful day and have enjoyed this webinar, and that you get to know the Water Energy Nexus and begin to tap into the energy for effluent, potable, dewatering, and wastewater. Thank you for listening to this webinar. Have a wonderful day and stay well.
Carry on, my wayward son. There'll be peace when you are done. Lay your weary head to rest. Don't you cry no more.